Welcome to the 2017 Tiny House Summit. Thank you for being here. When people talk to me about tiny house living, what they'll hear me talk a lot about is about following your dream. And for me, living in my tiny house is just that, it as a result of me following a dream. And it's a dream that I have had since my daughter was very young, since she was headed into kindergarten. And I knew I was a single parent, and it wasn't the easiest thing. I was also a young parent. And my dream at the time was that once she was grown, I wanted to live what I imagined would feel like a lighter or freer lifestyle. And when she was in kindergarten, headed into kindergarten, I actually kind of made a deal with her. And I always laugh and I say, as much as you can make a deal with a kindergartner. But my deal was that, you know, once she was grown, and I was going to, of course, put in the effort to be a great parent, which I hope and I think that I did. But once she was grown and successful, then I wanted to be able to follow my dream of living that lighter, freer lifestyle. And the deal was that once she was grown and had reached what, you know, at my mindset at that time was what society deemed successful, that once she was successful, that she would buy me an RV. And she agreed to it. Like I was saying earlier, it's kind of easy to get a kindergartner to agree to something. But it was something that we would talk about through the years as she grew up. It was kind of one of the things that I would remind her, hey, you know, as she was getting older and getting her grades and stuff, I'd remind her, you know, you've got to make good grades because you promised me that you're going to buy me an RV when you're successful. So it was just something that was ongoing for me, the dream, and then, you know, just a running conversation with she and I. And anybody that knows me through that time period will talk to you about my dream of living in an RV. I always said that once she was grown and headed off to college, you know, I'd be in my RV traveling around the country. I used to tell her, you know, I'm not going to have an address. It's going to be a P.O. box. I'll just show up randomly wherever you are. And, you know, she never really thought that part of it was cool. But that had just really been my dream. And so as she got older and was headed off to college, and I kind of got over the mommy anxiety piece where I, you know, now I've really got to figure out what to do with my life because she is gone and into, you know, doing her and living her life. So now I've got to figure out my part outside of just being mommy. So I started trying to figure out how I was getting into that lifestyle that I had dreamed of. And I had gone to a couple of RV shows and looking at RVs, you know, online, and realized that I would probably say I have some higher end taste. So the RVs that I was interested in really weren't in the price range of affordability for someone who wanted to live a lighter lifestyle. I also said, you know, I wanted to live that type of lifestyle where I could fish for my food, and it wasn't where I, you know, it wasn't based on having a set income, but it would just be kind of day by day. So the RVs that I was looking at just wouldn't work with that. I was absolutely going to have a job to pay for those RVs. So it was trying to figure out how to get to that lifestyle. And one night I stumbled upon tiny houses and just decided at that point that that was how I was going to do it, and started along the path. So let me go back to my following my dream, because a lot of times I have conversations with people who will say, well, you know, I have a dream of blah, blah, blah. Maybe they have a dream of living in a tiny house. And they don't understand, how do you get from the dream to the actual reality of or the plan, or where it actually you're actually able to realize that dream? And so I'll go back a little bit, because when my daughter left to go to undergrad and I started really in pursuit of the dream, I at that time owned a 4-bedroom, 3-bath house. And when she left to go to undergrad, as I said before, I kind of had mommy anxiety. We lived in Georgia and she headed to school in North Carolina. So I sold the house and I moved a couple of cities away from her in Charlotte. She was in Durham. And I started my downsizing process then in selling my house. And I knew at that point that I didn't intend to own a house again because I was headed toward that freer lifestyle. You know, I have nothing against home ownership. I just knew the plan that I had for myself didn't include owning a home again. And so, I would say a traditional home again. So at that time, like I said, I had the 4-bedroom, 3-bath house, and that was the beginning of my downsizing process. So I packed up the house. A lot of the stuff, I'd been in my house for 10 years. So you can imagine you've got your attic, you've got storage places. So my most major purge. And I packed up a lot of stuff that I ended up donating. I threw a lot of stuff out. And when I was leaving that house, I actually had what I would say was a two-car garage full of stuff that I actually donated and trashed, because you can accumulate a lot of stuff. If you've got a large size house, you really don't even sometimes know all of the stuff that you've accumulated, especially over, you know, the course of 10 years. So then I moved to Charlotte and I moved into a 3-bedroom, 3-bath condo at the time. And I was renting, the place. And I still, it wasn't, you know, a tiny space, but it was smaller than what I had been used to. And I had downsized a whole lot of belongings. But I still wasn't going into the tiny space. My daughter was headed off to college. I still wanted to have, you know, space for her when she would come home. But I still, in my mindset, knew that, you know, I was moving towards smaller. So, you know, my dream is still there. And I'm absolutely moving towards the plan, but I started mine and worked to it kind of gradually. So, you know, like people will reach out to me and say, well, you know, I've had this dream for 5-10 years, you know, and I still can't get there. My dream actually took the course of about 10 years. I sold my house in 2006. And so I didn't build my house until 2015, my tiny house until 2015. So it was, you know, 9-10 years that I was working my dream. So it doesn't have to happen immediately, but you still need to understand that you know, you've got this dream. You've got to be working towards the plan of making this dream happen. So from my 3-bedroom, 3-bath condo, I eventually downsized to a 2-bedroom, 2-bath apartment. Again, I wasn't buying anything because I knew my plan didn't involve being tied to selling something. And I eventually, over the course of that 10-year time period, right before I built my tiny home, I had moved to a 1-bedroom, 1-bath apartment. So, you know, in between the course of time between selling my house in 2005 and starting my tiny house build in 2015, I was living life. You know, things were happening, working, traveling. My life hadn't come to a standstill, but I still knew what my dream was and what my ultimate goal was. And so I was working accordingly to get to that plan. And what I'll say to everybody is, you know, a dream isn't just the thought bubble over your head, hey, you know, that pops up, this is what I want to do. You've got to put some action and some steps into making that dream come true to actually get to the reality of a dream. And that's where I think a lot of people get stuck in how they get from dream to actual reality. And so one of the things that I have done, and one of the things that I share with people in my speaking engagements and in consulting, is kind of breaking the word dreams down so that you understand the effort and the work that has to go into the realization of a dream. So if we start with the letter D of dreams, we'll assign the first word to dreams that starts with a D. We'll start it with due diligence. You are going to have to be willing to put in some work to plan how you're going to achieve your dream. Unless, of course, you're just wealthy and you can write a check and make the dream happen, you've got to do some due diligence. And so that often looks like research. For me, that was part of my, when I decided I was building a tiny house, I had to put in a lot of due diligence in researching. I'm a project manager by trade and nature, and part of my interest in tiny homes and interest in building my tiny home was in being able to be the subject matter expert for my build. I wanted to know all of the pieces of a tiny house and building a tiny house. And so before I got to the actual point of building my house in 2015, I had put in, excuse me, a year and a half, almost 2 years of researching to be able to understand the tiny house build as a whole. And that was part of my due diligence. Depending on what your dream is, your due diligence might look like a part-time job or cutting back if you need to save money to achieve your dream, or if it's some physical work, whatever it is that you need to put in the effort, whatever your dream is, you've got to put in some due diligence to be able to get to that dream. So it's about achieving a dream. It's also about working and to achieve that dream. So that's the due diligence. You've also got to have some dedication. You've got to be willing to commit yourself to your dream, especially if it's important to you. And if you're not willing to focus or commit and be dedicated to your dream, then you really can't expect to achieve it. And that's kind of the bottom line. You've got to be dedicated to that dream. And like I mentioned, my dream started when my daughter was in kindergarten, and I didn't hit the realization of my dream until, 10, 15 years later, though I was moving towards the course of that dream, and I was absolutely dedicated to it. There's another D word that's part of dreaming, and that word is, and it's often a tough word, it's disappointment. Because with your dream, sometimes there's going to come disappointment, either in you may not achieve your dream, or the dream may not end up exactly as you thought it would be. You've had this dream and then you get to it and the realization is that it's kind of disappointing, or it's not what you imagined. So you need to be prepared for disappointment. For me, a twist to that was that I knew when I designed my tiny house, once I had gotten out of the research phase and had worked to design the house, I knew that if it didn't turn out exactly the way that I had imagined it or the way it had been designed, that I was going to be disappointed. But I put in the due diligence. I was on site during my build almost every day, and I put in the due diligence in the upfront planning. And again, the dedication to being on site. And so remember, those are two of our other D words. To be able to mitigate any issues that happened on site, eliminate any potential disappointment. And so you've got to be prepared that there's some potential disappointment, but you can also put in some due diligence and some dedication to maybe eliminate or mitigate some of that disappointment. But you want to be prepared. Moving past the D in dreams, we'll get to the R. And one of the R words that I like to focus on in following a dream is resilience. This is really important because following a dream isn't going to be easy, and it's not always going to go as planned. So you've got to be willing to stay your course. You've got to be in it to win it. You know, that kind of sounds hokey, but it's really true that you've got to have some resilience and plant your feet and just kind of hold on to get to dreams. It's not always going to be easy, so your resilience is going to be a major factor in your ability to achieve your dream. Another R word that is part of dreams is resources. And your resources can stand for people, places, and things. But right now, I'll focus on the people piece of your resources. In following your dreams, you're going to want to surround yourself with a circle of friends and family that are going to have your back. And if you don't surround yourself with those type of people, that is not, that can be a factor in not achieving your dream. It, support is very important in achieving a dream, and people play a major role in being that support for you and being your resources. And I feel like if people aren't able to be that that resource for you, they're not willing to have your back, then I don't necessarily want them in my circle. And that can go for, you know, friends and family. It's important to me that I surround myself with great people, that I'm that they're pushing me to achieve my dreams, and that I'm doing the same thing for them. Because as you're, you know, depending on the complexity of your dream, you're often going to have to lean into your resources to help you achieve that dream. So your resources are very important to you in following your dreams. And I'll talk a little bit more about resources. The other piece of, or another R word as part of dreams, is to reciprocate. And I touched on that just a second ago. You want to have resources that have your back, but you also want to be the type of resource to your circle of friends and family that they can lean into to follow their dreams. You don't want to just be the taker. You also want to be the giver. And reciprocation is so very important. There's nothing worse than a one-sided relationship or people who don't give back. And you shouldn't want to be that person. Another R word for dreams is going to be realistic. You're going to have a dream that's realistic for you. And if I want to, if I relate realistic to tiny houses, oftentimes you'll see people talking about the cost of a tiny house and the worth of a tiny house. And it, that's always an ongoing debate where you'll see people say, well, that house just costs too much. I don't participate in those conversations, and I don't on my Facebook pages, I don't allow those type conversations. And one of the reasons that I don't is because I built my tiny house based on what was realistic for me, and the cost that I, the price of my tiny house was realistic for me. And I want to encourage everyone to do the same. What was realistic for my tiny house dream might not be realistic for someone else, and vice versa. And that's okay, because we should be basing our dreams on the reality of what, of self. And so you need to ensure that your dream is realistic for you. And one of the things that I like to say to everybody is that we all get to dream the dream that works for us. So, be sure that your dream is realistic for you. And then another important R word in the course of your dream is to reset. And this is a word that people often struggle with. I absolutely adore my tiny house. It is a part of a dream come true for me. But if I were to wake up tomorrow and decide that, you know, I no longer want to live in my tiny house anymore, for me, it is, that's okay. I believe that you're entitled to dream a new dream. I believe that you're entitled to go down a new path, to pursue a new dream for yourself, and to do a reset, and, you know, to just be okay with resetting. And that is one that I think a lot of people struggle with, because, you have the factor of other, what will other people think? And that's where I feel like you really need to remove that and do a reset based on the reality for you. Moving past the R's of dream, we'll get to the E. And one of the major E words for dreams is the effort. And this is very similar to your due diligence. You're not going to be able to, you can't expect to achieve your dream if you're not willing to put in the effort. And that's really, you know, kind of bottom line. There's not a lot that you can say about that other than you need to put in the effort. Another E word is expectations. And this is kind of a big one for me because I also see people talk a lot about, and I'll keep trying to relate this to tiny houses, in some of the social media groups that I follow, or some of the messages that I get, people will ask questions like, you know, how do I get my family on board with my tiny house dream? You know, they think I'm crazy. And for me, so I'm not talking about, you know, the husband and wives, or what I'm talking about is adults who are trying to get, you know, family members on board with their decisions. And I will say that I'm not big on managing to other people's expectations as related to my dreams. And another thing I'll say is that if you are following the plan and you've gotten to the R in dreams and you've got your resources around you and you've set your resources properly and accordingly, then this becomes less of an issue because your circle is going to be supportive of you and you don't have to be concerned so much with managing to expectations. And that's just not something that I try to put on my list to do. Another E word, and it's very important, is to envision it. And this is a big one for me, and it's always been something that I make as part of my dreams. And I can, when I was purchasing my first house, I probably would say that I was a stalker of my first house. You know, I decided the house that I was buying. We were in the process of buying the house, and I would go by, I would drive by the house just about every day, you know, to look at the house. My daughter, I would pick her up from school and we drive by the house. And she at some point was like, oh my God, are we going to the house again? But yes, we were going to the house again because for me, envisioning myself living in the house, you know, I'd get out and I'd walk around the property and I'd look in the windows and I would envision myself and my family in the house, enjoying that space. And when I was going through the process of designing my tiny house, I had kind of sketched out my tiny house on graph paper, and my sister took that and she put it to plans. And then I have another friend, Jamie, who had joined our team, our design team, and Jamie was the SketchUp queen. And so then we went from, you know, my graph paper to the plans, and then we went to the SketchUp model, which allowed me to envision. I don't know if you've ever seen SketchUp. It's really, it can be very realistic. And so that allowed me to envision myself living in my tiny house. And I could, you know, feel myself living in my tiny house. When I was looking for, right after I had built my tiny house and was in an RV park and I was looking for another parking space, I envisioned myself somewhere peaceful and happy, and that is the type parking space that I was able to achieve. And I feel like envisioning is so much of the achieving of a dream. You need to be able to envision it, to manifest it. So if we move past the E's and we now get to the A of your dreams, that'll take us to achievement. And I would say that achievement is a combination of several words and parts of your dream. It's achieving it is envisioning it and then expecting success. And that really is the only way that success is going to be your achievement. You have to envision it, you have to expect success, and then you get to your achievement. Another A word that's important as part of your dreaming is applause. And this is a big piece of it. And if you've set yourself up with the right resources in your circle, then they should be applauding you as you're working to achieve your dreams. And then, you know, we've got to be reciprocal, so you'll be applauding them as well. But just in case they aren't, this is a big piece for me, is that you've got to remember to applaud yourself. Remember to celebrate yourself and your achievements as you're working towards your dream. You know, they say take time to smell the roses. That's kind of really about the applause. Maybe your dream isn't going as you planned it, or it didn't turn out too well. You still need to applaud your effort that you put into it, that you took the risk to achieve your dream. And applause is a big piece of achieving dreams, and you want to remember to applaud for yourself, or to clap for yourself is probably the better way to say it, but the word is applaud. Another A word is to ask. This is big and this is hard for me. In my tiny house build, I need to ask for help. And that was a tough one for me because I'm usually the helper. But I needed to ask for help. And you'll need to remember to also ask for what it is that you want. And so asking is a big piece of achieving dreams. If we move past the A's, we now get to the M in dreams. And one of the first words that I like to talk about as an M word is measurable. And this is part of planning. This is a big piece of planning. It's part of your due diligence in that you just can't decide that you're going after a big dream without having put some thought into how you're going to get from A to Z. And then also having some checkpoints along the way so that you're able to measure your success and determine whether or not you're on track for achieving it. And then sometimes with these checkpoints, then you're going to have to make adjustments as necessary. As I worked toward getting to the freer lifestyle, I started with selling my house. Again, I knew that my ultimate goal was to live a lighter, freer lifestyle, and I worked accordingly. Like I mentioned, I didn't want to own anything else because I knew I wanted to have the flexibility and the freedom to move about, and I wanted to be able to evolve into smaller spaces, and I had to do that to be able to get to where I am now. So having measurable dreams so that you have checkpoints and you know how you're getting from start to finish, and you can check in to see if you're on task or if you're on point, is measurable. Another M word, and it's really not an M word, but I like to include it in my conversations about following your dreams, is to man up or woman up. And when I talk about that, it's the being tough part of following your dreams. And you often have to be tough. And this goes back to your resilience, where you plant your feet and you get ready for the long haul. Oftentimes, achieving dreams will lead to heartbreak. I mean, it's not necessarily going to be an easy path, whatever your dream is. And it doesn't have to relate just to tiny houses, but you can relate it to building a tiny house. And I'll absolutely say it wasn't the easiest thing I've ever done. I have likened it to the course of my build to being a single parent, condensed in a 3-month bill. It was absolutely a tough thing. And I had to man up or woman up and be resilient and be tough and stand in it. And I will say that that's also part of your resources, because when you get to your tough spots, then your resources are going to be there to help you as well, to stand into your dream. Another M word that's important in dreaming is to marinate in it. And this is very similar to your applause, where I say to people as they're working to follow a dream and achieve a dream, is to not be so focused on achieving the dream that you don't allow your success along the way to soak in. Take your time and enjoy the process along the way. And for me, this was one of, I would say, probably the things that I missed about my tiny house build. It was happening so fast. We were filming for HGTV. The timeline was short, and there was so much going on in the background that I didn't often have the time to marinate in what was going on. My build was stressful, That is, I probably would say, one of my regrets of my build is that I didn't take more time to allow my successes along the way to soak in. And I did, some, of course, but in looking back, hindsight is 2020, there was more opportunity for that. And I wish I had marinated in my success a little bit more along the way. Another M word, or two M words, your motivation or your magic. And this is what I will say, it relates to your belief system. Whatever your belief system is, you are going to have to dig into it to help you achieve your dream or dreams, and to sustain you as things get rough, if things get rough, when things get rough, and they will get rough along the course. But your motivation and your magic that you lean into is what will help you get through to achieving your dream. And that's a very important part of dreaming, to be able to stand into your belief system, whatever that is. Another M word is mistakes. And this is a big one. Mistakes are going to be made along the way in following dreams. And if you know that up front, you accept that, you embrace it, but you don't let it defeat you. You don't let it make you give up. You go back to the M word of manning up, womanning up, and you keep working toward your dream and you reset. You see what I did there? You reset if you need to, but you understand, if you understand from the beginning that mistakes are going to happen, then it's not as earth-shattering when they do. Then we move from the M into the S, and one of my S words for following dreams is your support system. And this, again, is a big one. I think they're all big. I probably have said that for every word in achieving dreams. But if you've got your resources in place, and remember I assigned the resources to being the people, if you've got them in place, then you've got that part of your support system and you're going to need them. And if you've got the right people as your resources, where I talked about making sure the people in your circle are the right people, they're going to support you because they love you. And that's what your good circle of friends are going to do. They're going to support you. You love them, you support them. And that's just how it's supposed to work if you've got the right resources set up. But I'll bring this to tiny houses. They might not be able to relate to your dream at 100% as you're going through working to achieve your dream. So if I relate this to my tiny house experience, my circle of friends, they were absolutely supportive of the fact that I had a dream to build a tiny house. Most of them couldn't relate to it because tiny houses weren't very popular. It's like, you're building a tiny house, what are you doing? But they were supportive. Hey, that's your dream, go for it, we've got your back. So part of your support system is also going to look like aligning yourself with people who have similar dreams. And for tiny house people, that can be a tiny house group, that can be going to a tiny house meetup, it could be a tiny house conference where you're meeting other people who have the same dream as you or a similar dream to you. They're on the same path, and this helps to kind of bolster your spirit. As you're hitting your mistakes along the way, or you're hitting the parts of your dream that aren't going to plan, then you're able to have some conversations with some people who can relate to more of what you're going through. And then, if need be, if they might be a little bit further along the path than you, you might be able to follow their example, some of the paths that they forged to help you get through. And this is key to following a dream. You've got your resources in place, but you also want to have an excellent support system. And it's very important and valuable to have that support system. If I talk to the support system in my tiny house build, my build was tough. There was personality conflicts between me and my builder. Like I mentioned, we were filming for HGTV, where you want to have the stress that you have going on behind the scenes. I didn't necessarily want all of that to play out in on camera, on film, for the world to see. When I was planning my build, when I built my tiny house, I kind of hit at the early point of before, I would say, luxury tiny homes were really acceptable. And so there was a lot of thought in the tiny house community that, you know, you don't spend over X amount of dollars. And then this goes back to, you know, setting your dream so that it's based on your expectations and realistic for you. But and so there weren't a lot of houses in the community for me to compare my plan for my tiny house build was. And I was managing a lot of my process and figuring out my budget. And I exceeded my budget almost to the tune of 2 times what I thought I was going to spend for my tiny house. So I had the stress of the personality conflicts with working with my builder, being on HGTV, my financial stresses. And so there was a time that I wanted to quit, and I'm really not a quitter. But, you know, like I've said before, I felt like when I've compared my tiny house build to being a single parent, just condensed in a matter of 3 months, it was absolutely tough. You know, me being a single parent was from, you know, birth to maybe if you want to go to age 21. So to condense that in a matter of 3 months, when I say it was tough, it was absolutely tough. And my support system, my resources, my circle wouldn't let me quit. They reminded me of my why, excuse me, and my dream, you know, my long-standing dream. And they stood me back up at a time when I couldn't stand on my own. And so this is why your resources and your support system are so important as you work toward following your dream. The next S word and the final S word that I, or the final word that I'll focus in on in as following your dreams is success. And what I'll say to this is if you've gone through the word dreams with me and you've followed everything that we've talked about as we've broken down the word, then you're going to get to success. And the other part of success is that as you're looking at your dream, you've got to know that it's going to happen. You've got to already assign success to it. And you need to be able to stand in that success, trust your process, and own it. And that's what success of dreams looks like. As I share and break down dreams to people that I work with in my consultations or when I speak about following your dreams, I always share a quote from Harriet Tubman that I feel like speaks so much to breaking down the dreams and understanding everything that goes into a dream. And the Harriet Tubman quote goes a little bit like this, or goes like this. Every great dream begins with a dreamer. Always remember you have within you the strength, the patience, and the passion to reach for the stars to change the world. So I encourage everyone to put the plan into following your dreams and design a life that you love. So now that we've gotten through dreaming, I will answer some of the questions, a lot of the questions that I get from people, emails, questions when I'm speaking, just overall about me, about my tiny house. And I've captured some of the questions, and I think through watching and participating in the Tiny House Summit, you may have a chance to ask additional questions, and so feel free to do so. People ask about the dimensions of my tiny house. So my tiny house is 28 feet long. I have, it's 8'6" wide in the basic 13'5" tall, 13'6" tall. It also have an additional 4-foot screened-in porch. And I have a Juliet balcony off of my upper master loft. My tiny house, the space is about 360 square feet of interior space if I count my two lofts. I have a very nice sized bathroom, a tub, and if you've watched my HGTV episode or have read anything on my my tiny house blog, you know that my tiny house space, my bathroom, I've always said that I'm a girly girl, and part of building my tiny house was I didn't want to feel like I was giving up anything in building my tiny house. I still wanted to have some of I guess I would call what the luxury of previous homes that I've had. You know, one of my taglines is I'll say that you don't have to give up luxury to go tiny, and that was absolutely one of the things that I incorporated in the design and planning of my tiny house. So I have a nice sized bathroom, tub, I have a walk-in closet, I have a galley kitchen. It's a you can cook a small meal. You can actually cook a large meal. I've got a 2-burner cooktop. I have a microwave and convection oven. I always say that cooking isn't one of my main things. I can cook, just for anybody that's wondering, but it's not something that I love to do. So my kitchen was less of my focus, even though I wanted to build or include a very functional kitchen. And so I do have that. I have a kind of eat-in nook off of my kitchen that can do double duty as a workspace or an eat-in space. And I have a very open area for seating and for guests. It was always important to me that my tiny house remain very comfortable. My house has always been kind of a gathering spot for friends, and I wanted my tiny house to remain that as well. Another question that I'm often asked is, how long have you lived in your tiny house? And I did touch on that. I have lived in my tiny house. The build was completed in May of 2015, and I have lived in my tiny house since then, almost coming up on 2 years. before getting to build, and this is something that is important, and I share this information with everyone, I put in, like I said, a year and a half, almost 2 years of planning and research, for my tiny house build. And I think that has been what was the main key to my success of living in my tiny house and in enjoying my tiny house. Another question that I'm often asked is, what would you change about your house? Or is there anything that you change about your house? And I would have to say, thankfully, no, there isn't anything that I would change about my tiny house. And that goes back to what I just spoke about, my 2 years of researching. Part of that process was paying attention to how I used my space in my larger homes and knowing my requirements for a tiny house. So there hasn't been anything that I've wanted to change about my tiny house. So I did do, you know, a couple of things, like during my build, like I mentioned, we were on a timeline. I ordered a sink that when the sink came in during the initial build, I knew that for my kitchen, I knew that it was too small. So we went ahead and installed the sink. I didn't have the time to swap it out. So we installed the sink, but I knew at some point that I was going to swap that sink out. So I did do that. There is a window in my eat-in nook area that, after living in the house, I realized I should have ordered an opening window. So I did change that window out. But as far as the overall design and structure, there has not been anything that I've wanted to change about my tiny house. And I'm very thankful for that. Another question that I often get is, how was it being on HGTV? It was absolutely fabulous. There are a number of tiny house shows, and what I will say about my HGTV show is that they didn't have any input in my design or my build or any of that. They were just really documenting the process. And I had a great team that I worked with when they would come out on site, a great team, you know, in the background that I worked with. And I absolutely enjoyed my HGTV experience. And I don't have anything other than what I mentioned earlier about the stress within my actual build. It was, of course, filming added to it because I wanted to present my best face on TV, but it didn't have anything to do actually with HGTV. It was just some you know, internal bill stress. And the fact that, you know, we had a deadline. I had a deadline to be out of my apartment. I had a deadline that we'd agreed upon in the beginning for my filming. And so that kind of factored in, but it again wasn't a result of actually, you know, HGTV and being on the show. excuse me. Another question that I'm asked, what's your favorite part of your house? And I would probably say all of it. That was key to me designing the house, is that I wanted it to be something that I absolutely loved, and I do. I enjoy all of my windows. I am a sunshine chaser, lover, all of that. And so my windows allow for a lot of light, and I love that about the house. I love my comfortable seating area. I have a love sack, sectional. It's very comfortable, and I enjoy being in that space. I absolutely love my loft space as well. It's not, you know, people will often ask, you know, don't you get claustrophobic? My tiny house with the open windows and the space, you know, it's a 28 footer, so it's kind of on the bigger end of a tiny house. I don't. And I enjoy that, my loft space as well. And I don't know that I have a favorite part of the house. I would say I just enjoy the tiny house is my favorite part of my house. Another question that I get is your tiny house your forever plan? And I will say, I don't know. The thing about dreams is that, like I said, you get to reset. You get to dream a new dream. I've been in the house for 2 years. And when even, you know, before hitting year two, it was always my thought process is that, like I said, in breaking down the word dreams, if I woke up one day and decided that I was done with this dream, then I allow myself that opportunity to dream a new dream. So I'm very happy in my house, and I don't have a plan right now today for doing anything different, but I can't say 100% that it's my forever plan, just based on what, you know, the flexibility that I give myself to follow new dreams. Another question that I often get is, what advice do you have for someone that's interested in the movement and in building a tiny house? My most important advice is to do the due diligence, to ensure that tiny house living is for you, to visit tiny homes, to participate in consultations, to do some research and put in that upfront work, understand your requirements for your personal space if you have a family, understand all of what that looks like and put in the time for that research. And that to me is the key to being successful in a tiny house. And I would advise anyone that's interested in tiny house living and building a tiny house to do that work. Another question that I get is, you know, what's the most challenging thing about living in a tiny house? For me, because I put in that upfront work in the design piece, living in the house really isn't challenging at all. I absolutely love my house. And if I were to say anything that's challenging about it, is probably what is the most known thing, the parking. I have been very successful in finding a great parking space. One of the draws for me is that it's a little bit further out in the suburbs, and I'm more of the city girl. I like to be in the midst of everything that's happening. So that's been a challenge for me, but I think that I've located a spot that's going to allow me to move closer into the city. But I'm very thankful for the spot that where I am now. It's a beautiful spot. The property owner is one of the most gracious hosts, and I really enjoy being here. But I would say that parking is probably the most challenging thing. But anybody that talks to me, I will say it's challenging, but it's not impossible. So I built not having a parking spot. So I knew that I would find a parking spot. And I did. And it's been great. So I don't discourage anyone from building based on that being a challenge. Because I also say that, you know, it's doable. It takes some effort, but it's doable. Another question, and then I will use this as my final question. What has been the most rewarding thing for you? And I would probably say the realization of my lighter, freer dream that I had when my daughter was going into kindergarten, to get to the realization of, you know, I've achieved this dream, the culmination of my tiny house being that dream, and to be able to look back through my build process and to know how tough that was, and then to have stuck it out and to have my research pay off to where it's something, my tiny house is something that I absolutely love. And, you know, in the tough days, and, you kind of can look around at your tiny house and be like, you know, wow, this is very cool. This is amazing. I've achieved a major dream. And I would say that probably is the most rewarding thing for me. Thank you.